You're listening to the Drive U podcast, where the automotive industry comes to stay ahead of the curve, with your host, author, and head of innovation, Frankie Russo.
Welcome back to another podcast of Drive University. Really excited to have Ken Luna on the phone. Ken is actually been in the business for quite some time. I'll let him tell us a little bit about that. But Ken is very passionate about something that I've discovered to be an incredibly important part of really having a powerful CX strategy, especially when it comes to marketing and having more personal, educated conversations that are more relevant to each one of these consumers. And that's specifically around this concept of pre-screening credit in order to have a much better picture of where someone is at before even having a conversation with them. So I'm really excited about this chat today. Ken, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here. Thanks for asking me.
Yeah, man. So listen, tell us a little bit about how you got in the automotive space and then specifically how you landed in this credit pre-screening world.
Okay, so I've been in automotive a long, long time. I won't say exactly how long, but it goes way back to the early dawning of technology in the auto industry, way probably before, you know, most people's time on this call. But over the years, what I have been focused on has been leading edge technologies. That's just been something I've always thought was interesting and really kind of fun to be in when you're bringing new ideas. You know, I was at the forefront of CRMs, websites, even a lot of changes in the DMS world. I've been involved in all of those over my tenure, if you will. On the credit end, I got involved with CreditMiner about 7 years ago. You know, a lot has changed in that 7 year period of time, but even then, the concept of being able to take a look at someone's credit early on in the process always intrigued me. I thought it was a great idea, and then the way that it evolved and got structured was really kind of a win-win for both the consumer and for the dealership if it's used properly. So that's the key, is making sure that it's deployed and used in a compliant and a proper manner.
I love it. Well, you know, when it comes to using the pre-approval process and with like a pre-screen soft pull credit, why is that so valuable in your mind?
So we've done a lot of research and analysis, and from an engagement standpoint, it's one of the top, if not the top, engagement, if you will, from a an email marketing or a website, getting people to engage. And the reason for that is that if you think about it, people like to know ahead of time whether they're going to get approved or not, and more importantly, what they can get approved for before ever going into the dealership, before ever talking to anybody. And the main reason for that is they don't want to be embarrassed. You know, they don't want to get into the dealership and find out that, oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Luna, you can't qualify for this because of XYZ. And at one point in time or another, to a certain degree, that's happened to someone, or they can qualify, but not for the car they want. So what this does is that takes that, you know, that engages the consumer right up front with that, and makes them feel better about the fact that, yes, you will be able to get into this car for this, you know, up to a certain amount of money and as low as a particular percentage rate based on, you know, income, based on other factors as well. That's kind of in the disclaimer. So so that's really the main reason. And we know statistically it's a high engagement mechanism, if you will, using that pre-approval on the communication that you're putting in front of the consumer.
I love that. So, you know, it's interesting. I've been thinking of it both ways. So the CX component, I'm very passionate about CX as it relates to mainly automating personalization and making it to where it's accessible to the salesperson to be more confident about who they're talking to and what is going on with this individual. But I like what you said about the customer experience as far as the embarrassment and the emotions around being approved, right? And so that's a really powerful thing that we have to be thinking about, those emotions when it comes to this type of marketing and the overall impact and experience that they're going to walk away from with this dealership. So I love that. Why is it so important in your mind to have that like required firm offer of credit to be accurate? You know, that's something that you've talked to me in the past about. Why is that so important?
It's one of the things that I preach, because it's being done wrong so many ways in the industry right now. Mm. And, you know, I'm just surprised.
Well, tell me a little bit about how, what you mean, like, what are some of the things you're seeing that are wrong? Cause I know for me, I obviously believe in this concept. I use it and built it into the DRiVE CXM, but you know, I haven't seen all the wrong, as much of the wrong things as you have. Tell me a little bit about that.
So basically, this goes all the way back to the FCRA, which that spawned the birth of soft credit pulls way back when. And the FCRA kind of breaks it in. It back then, it didn't call it pre-screen and pre-qualify, but it basically breaks.
Now, what is the FCRA?
That's the Fair Credit Reporting Act.
Okay, sorry. Of course.
So, I mean, that's a big, long, huge monster document, but
in a previous life 2 decades ago, I was in the mortgage business, like before.
Oh, okay, so you're familiar.
Yeah, before the mortgage meltdown, back when everybody was doing it, and so I knew enough to be trouble in with credit back then, but it was always, you know, the full credit report, 3 bureaus and that stuff. So I was very familiar with all the regulations in order to be licensed and whatnot.
Yeah. Well, there's similarities in the industries. I mean, the mortgage industry does use credit pulls, and they're under the same rules and regulations, you know, as the automotive industry.
Yeah.
So basically, a pre-screen, technically speaking, a pre-screen can be done with or without a consumer's permission, if you will. You have to have permissible purpose, which means all that means is that you have to be in line to do business with them. You're wanting to sell them something or do some type of transaction with them, whether it be a mortgage or selling them a car or selling them insurance or whatever. That's part of what the law says. Now, for a pre-screen, what it says is that you must, you know, if they pass the criteria that is set forth, and you can set what that criteria is, like a minimum FICO score or whatever. But if they pass that, then you have to issue a firm offer of credit. So a great example of this is Capital One. Capital One uses pre-screens to the umpteenth degree. I think every other week I'm getting some type of correspondence from them about I've been pre-approved for a credit card or a car loan or whatever.
Yeah, they're the kings of that.
That's
how they're doing it. Yep.
That's how they're doing it. So they're doing it in bulk, which is fine. That's great for mass mailings, for large volume mailings, but that's not typically what you see in our industry. Our industry is more of a real-time environment where you're wanting to know right then and there what the credit position of this individual is and let them know instantly or at some short period of time, you know, what they have been pre-approved for. So the real problem is the industry doesn't do a very good job with the pre-approval process. And that is that a good example would be one of the vendors out there just does a certificate and it says you've been pre-approved from $5,000 to $50,000. And it doesn't matter what the score is. I mean, they just, they send that out to everybody.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of things that from a in discussing this with the bureaus, there are other laws that come into play, the truth in lending, things like that. So when you're implying to someone that they can purchase a car in the $50,000 range and they're sitting there with a 540 FICO score, that's misleading.
Okay. So that's some of the stuff you're actually seeing out there where they're making an offer of credit that's not based on anything. Yikes.
Correct. So basically the system has to be designed such to where, like in our case, we use 5 credit tiers and the firm offer is based upon whatever credit tier they fall into. And then a lot of our digital retailing API customers that use our interface, they even tie it in, they can even tie it into bank platforms and their particular lending platforms, if you will, as to, you know, the different programs they have depending upon what the score is. So so that's important. And it's being done wrong in a lot of cases, and we're very sensitive to that. Now, there's another type of soft pull that's called a pre-qualification. And the issues that we've had with pre-qualifications is that the law specifically states that to do a pre-qualification, you have to have the consumer's permission. Now, the good thing about a pre-qualification, it basically gives you the same information as a hard pull. I mean, you get the full file, but you have to be careful about the fact that, you know, proving if you ever get audited by the state or some regulatory commission, if you will, that you did in fact get permission from that individual to do that pull. So a signature.
You have to make sure your technology is set up very strongly.
Right. Your signature will suffice, things like that, or you can ask for the last four of the social, or you can ask what they call out-of-wallet questions. You do all of these things. The problem with those is those are lead killers. So when you start engaging someone that's early in the process with all of these questions, they just say, forget this. You know, I'm not going to, and we know because we've tried using pre-quals and these identifiers. I will say this, the industry, in looking at some of the newer things that are coming out, and they're just now being released, a little more promising in that area, such as tying it to the SIM card or the cell phone, making sure that that is, and at least that phone is owned by the person that they say they are, things like that. Those are things we're exploring with the bureaus, but it's going to take that level before we're comfortable enough to do pre-qualifications, you know, especially with the way that we use them with online. Because online is a little more sensitive as to really knowing the person is who they say they are or not. And really, quite frankly, the pre-screens for early in the process and what they're being utilized for work extremely well. So
exactly.
We really haven't had any issues with that. So well, that's kind of an overview.
Okay, good. Yeah. And so like from a marketing, using it as a marketing, like powerful tool, what are some ways that you're seeing dealerships really have success using that? Using the pre-screen data, I know of some, but I'd like to know from you, what are you seeing out there that are some of the top two or three things that dealers are using this for to be able to be successful, use it as a marketing tool, and also maybe how salespeople at the dealership are using it?
So, and we haven't talked very much about what the dealer gets out of this at this point, so we'll spend a second on that as well. But where it's absolutely being used most successfully is on, well, there's two areas. One is websites, and the other is in really any type of marketing, but the most successful is, and if it's done correctly, is the email marketing piece, because you've got an email that comes across, or you go to a website and it says get pre-approved. Now, on a website, it could say it on the homepage, but where it's most prevalent is on the vehicle display page, which is also known as a VDP, where the individual vehicle comes up and then it says one of the options is get pre-approved. That's a very high engagement area. And from a dealership standpoint, when this soft pull is done, real time, and this pumps right into their CRM system, is the current FICO score, depending upon the lender, but it's typically the FICO 8 auto score, because that's what most lenders use, going into their CRM along with other valuable data, all their trade line data, all of their information about how many hard pulls have been done in the last 30 days. So it's just a lot of valuable data that is there for your team, if you will, to gauge and know which particular car, even though let's say this person's looking at, you know, $70,000 car, and they come back with a 580 FICO score. Well, before you even communicate with them, you already know that unless they have a substantial amount of money that they're going to put down on this car, you might want to be steering them towards something, you know, a little mm-hmm. less expensive. So that's the pre-knowledge and the communication and the ability to use that information is key when you're getting back with these individuals that you're engaging with, especially via the email marketing or via the website.
Wow. Yeah. And I think at the, you know, for us, we've used it a lot for equity mining, and it can do some really powerful things there, especially when you don't already have the finance information, you know, mm-hmm. and I think that's where being able to have educated conversations with service customers that have never bought from you, or people, or consumers and customers that bought but paid cash, right? Or they brought financing from their bank and we don't really know the details on it or where they're at with it. Exactly. You know, one of the things that I always liked about what you were doing is that you've got this VIN to loan match technology mm-hmm. That allows for us to identify where they're at, specifically with where a trade line matches up with a VIN. Can you tell us a little bit about how that technology works and how you're seeing people utilize it?
Yeah, and it actually goes one step beyond that now. It's now license plate to VIN to loan. And awesome. And I tell you where you see this, and I know car dealers are very sensitive to this. When I just saw an ad today that Carvana had on TV talking about, you know, selling, you know, buying your car. And
right.
The fact that, hey, you just type in your license tag, type in your name, and then bam.
That's the new thing. Because nobody knows their VIN number because it's so dang long.
Exactly. I mean, well, so that's, you know, they may be able to.
So now you're able to track the identifier. Yeah, yeah. It's like, because like it's in your glove compartment. You know, it's like, as opposed to just walk outside taking a peek at the license plate. So that's interesting.
What most people will do, they may not know their license number either, but they'll just walk out and take a picture of it on their phone and then come back in and type in their license number. That's simple.
Yeah.
And the license to VIN matching and then the VIN to loan matching. It really enables if you have the valuation service, you know, such a KBB or a Black Book or whatever, and you're matching it up against that information, you can do a real-time equity calculation within 5 to 10 seconds. You can not only find out where they are from a credit standpoint, but whether they're upside down or not on that particular car that you're thinking about having them trade in or even buying from.
And the way you it works is that you actually, as far as like the automation side where the dealership can take advantage of that automation, like with a system like RCXM, we're basically sending you the VIN information we already have on that customer when we go along with the request for prescreen. Is that how it's working?
Yeah, correct. So if you already have, like in the service drive, about half the time, just remember this though, in the service drive, depending upon the demographics, about half the time, that people get service done, they didn't necessarily buy the car there,
right?
Or they may not
more
have
than
ever
half
had
the
car service there. Yeah,
that's right.
Right,
that's right.
So if you have access to the VIN through the DMS system, that's great. That makes it even easier.
Yeah, that's how we do it.
Yeah, then if you can still find it with the license to VIN technology as well, and it works. You know, and then it's going to work the same way because now I've got the VIN. Now I can match that up against the valuation service. Now I can look at, you know, that particular car and see what their equity position is versus what the value of the car is. You know, and they're, you know, selling a car out of the service drive is very popular and has been for a while. It's not the easiest thing to do. I mean,
right.
but
having this information up front makes a big difference in the way that the conversation goes. Yeah, it doesn't feel
exactly
as spammy.
Right.
And that's something I'm very passionate about with what we've been building. Well, this is awesome. I definitely, I've gotten a lot out of this chat and I think a lot of dealerships that aren't aware of this type of technology, I hope that they'll reach out and ask a little more about it because this is something that could supercharge a lot of people's current strategies right now. People are looking for ways to do more database marketing, to use the data they have on their own customers and get more data around that as opposed to just trusting the big companies like Google and Facebook to give them that information, you know, and so lots changing. And then it's never been harder to find inventory. But the one thing that has not slowed down is that service lane. So being able to use these types of tools to automate that, I think is very powerful and something that each dealership has to be looking at right now if they want to stay competitive in this very, very difficult climate.
No, you're absolutely right. You're spot on with that.
Awesome. Well, Ken, thank you so much for being on Drive U today. Looking forward to talking to you more in the future and having you back on the show.
Yeah, lots of fun things to discuss. So always good seeing you again, Frankie.
You got it, man. Have a great day.
All right. Take care.